All right. Hello, and thank you to everyone for joining us for today's webinar, Understanding Your Pension. My name is Candace Jasak, and I'm a member of the mobilization team at the PIPSC National Office in Ottawa. I'm joined today by John Stark from our compensation team. John is our subject matter expert on our members' pensions. Thanks so much for joining us today, John.
Hello, my pleasure.
Before we get started, I will go over some key information about our platform Zoom. So due to the size of the group, we've muted all lines to ensure we have the best sound quality for everyone participating today and for those who will watch this later. Please use the chat box to send a message to us should you have any questions or technical issues during the webinar. My colleague Catherine Gagnon is monitoring that chat box and will be able to help you out. And the session is being recorded and will be circulated to everyone soon afterwards. So you can always take a look at this one more time if you're keen to do so. All right, so let's get started with a quick poll. The question is, how would you rate your knowledge of pensions? So you should see a question pop up on your screen now. You can go ahead and vote. And I'll give you a little bit of time to do that. All right, I'll give you about 10, 15 more seconds. So if you haven't voted, go ahead and do that. You should see the poll on your screen. All right, so let's take a look at those results. I can see that 29% of folks on today's call feel they have no knowledge whatsoever or very little knowledge of pensions. 68% of folks feel they have some knowledge, and only 3% of folks feel they have a lot of knowledge. Great, thanks again for participating in that poll. It gives us a great starting point for today's webinar. I'll take this moment to note that this presentation is designed to give you a high-level overview of how your pension works. Pensions are highly technical and governed by legislation, which, as we know, can change from time to time. This presentation is designed to give you a general understanding of how pensions work and how your pension supports your future retirement security. You should always contact your HR department for specific details and before making any major decisions related to your pension. All right, so today we will focus on the basics of how different pension types work with a closer look at your specific pension type. We'll talk about the idea of retirement income security and the role your pension plays in that, and we'll take a look at what PIPSC has planned to protect your pension. So, John, can you get us started by simply explaining what a pension is? I think many of us have a general understanding of what a pension is, but also find the details a bit complicated and confusing.
Sure, it's my pleasure, and I'd like to welcome everybody for joining this pension session. So a pension is an income that you receive when you retire. That part is simple. Where it gets a little bit more complicated is, where does that money come from? So over the course of your working career, both you and your employer contribute into the pension plan. Those contributions are then invested, and upon your retirement, they're paid from the investment fund. So basically, your pension is forced savings on your part and deferred salary on the part of the employer.
Okay, I think that's a really important point. So employees and employers pay into pensions over time, the money is invested, and upon retirement, the pension comes from those investments. Is that right?
That's correct. Your pension is a combination, as I said, of deferred savings and deferred compensation, and you get an annuity. It's not a big pile of money that you get at retirement.
Okay, and there are different types of pensions, correct?
Yes, there are different types of pensions. Most of our members have a defined benefit plan. A defined benefit pension plan guarantees an income at retirement. Some of our members are in target benefit plans, This type of plan also provides an annual income at retirement, but it isn't guaranteed. And then we have a few members in defined contribution pension plans.
And what governs a pension? Who sets the rules for your pension plan?
That's a good question. So basically, the rules are set up by pension legislation, and that's normally a provincial responsibility. The next most important document would be the plan document, and that goes over the plan specifics. For example, your pension entitlements, how the plan is funded, how it's invested, and in the case of target benefit plans, what you would do in the case of a problem. I'd remind everyone here today that's listening that this presentation is just to give you a general understanding of how your pension works and how this supports your future retirement security.
Okay. So all the members who are invited to today's webinar are from groups that have a target benefit pension plan. John, can you walk us through a target benefit pension plan in a bit more detail?
Sure. So let's start again with the contributions. Over the course of your working life, both you and your employer contribute to the plan. Those funds are invested, and then on retirement, your pension is paid from those investments. So it's basically for savings. With a target benefit plan, you'll also get an annual income when you retire, and it goes on until you die.
So we've been hearing a lot about target benefit plans or shared risk plans, and not all of it is good. How do target benefit plans stack up against other types of pensions?
Well, target benefit plans are quite similar to defined benefit plans in almost every way. They do pay an annual income until you pass away. However, target benefit plans have more risk for the members. For example, if the investments in the plan fund don't get a good enough return, then the plan can fall into a solvency situation. That means there isn't enough money in the plan according to the plan actuary. If this happens, then it's up to the members to decide what to do. In a defined benefit plan, this problem falls on the employer, but in a target benefit plans, it falls onto the members. So what that means is that if the funds don't do well in the market, the members may have to pay higher contributions, not the employer, the members, or retirees could have their pension cut a little bit. So in short, a target benefit plan basically operates like a defined benefit plan until something goes wrong. But a target benefit plan is still a very good plan because your contributions are pooled and invested together and professionally. So the pension fund is better prepared to weather short-term dips in the market. So it's better than a defined contribution plan. And of course, it's better than having no plan at all.
Of course. That makes sense. So how can we protect our target benefit pensions from employers that may want to move to a defined contribution pension or away from providing pensions altogether?
Well, everyone needs to understand their pension and how it works. That's important. We also need to have our members, you know, stand with us, with PIPS, to let employers know that, you know, we're not going to let them undermine our pensions, that we're going to push back if they do that.
Right. Yeah. And I think here we're really underlining that that pension is a combination of your savings and deferred compensation. Right. So that's, I think, a really important piece to note. Where can our members find more information about their personal pensions? For example, how much can a member expect to receive when they retire?
I get this question quite often, but unfortunately, we don't have the individual members' records. So, I don't have your salary, your years of service. I don't have anything to be able to calculate your pension. So the member should go to their HR department or to the plan administrator, and they could provide that information and give them a pension estimate.
Okay. And in general, what happens if a member changes their job or leaves their job before they retire? What happens to their pension?
Well, in that case, the member would get options. Such as converting the pension into a locked-in RSP, where you could also have part of it cashed out. The cashed out part you would pay tax on. Or you can take a deferred pension, and that would mean that you would leave it with the employer until such time as you retire, and then you would start your pension at that time.
Okay. But they would get that information from their HR department as they're getting ready to sort of exit their job.
Yeah. Okay. So when they terminate or they're thinking of terminating, they could ask for those options and what the values are, and then they can make a decision. And once they have that information, they can contact us and we can go over that so they can understand it and make an informed decision. But we can't do the first part because we don't have that information.
Right. That makes sense. Okay. So that's a lot of great information. But we also know that our workplace pension alone isn't the only part of a secure retirement.
That's right. Your workplace pension is only one part of your retirement income. You shouldn't stop there. There's more retirement planning to do.
Can you give us a bit more detail on that?
For sure. So pensions are considered a three-legged stool. First, you have your government retirement programs. This would be your CPP or QPP in Quebec, your old age security, and if you qualify as low income, guaranteed income supplement or GIS. So then you also have your personal savings. This would include your RRSPs, your registered retirement savings plan, or your TFSAs, tax-free savings account, and any other savings or investments that you have. And a final one is your actual workplace pension. So all three of them together, your government pensions, the OAS and CPP, and your personal savings and your workplace pension all together make your secured retirement.
I see. So I know a lot of my friends and family don't have a workplace pension at all. Is that common?
Unfortunately, yes. Only about 35% of Canadians have a workplace pension, and less than half of those have a defined benefit pension plan or a target benefit pension plan like our members do.
Is it possible to get by on just CPP or QPP and OAS and GIS? And how are folks, how do personal savings factor into that?
Well, living off just government programs would leave a lot of people in poverty. A lot of seniors are in poverty just with CPP, OAS, and therefore are receiving GIS payments. But even then, it's a difficult retirement. For the youth today, many of which have precarious jobs, only on temp or et cetera, that could lead to a very difficult, precarious retirement. According to Stats Canada, in 2018, only about 22% of the people that filed their taxes contributed into an RRSP. And the average household savings was only about $850. This is very low, and you won't be able to sustain yourself well. You'd be in poverty when you retire. This is why PIPS is focused on protecting our members' pensions and why the Canadian labor movement is fighting for pensions for all Canadians.
All right. Well, that's a ton of great information. So thanks for that, John. Before we move on, I do want to do another quick poll to see how folks are feeling. So given all the information we've just thrown at you, how would you rate your knowledge of pensions now? So just give me one second here. All right, you should see the question on your screen again. So go ahead and plug in your answers. Give you a little bit of time to do that. Give you about another 10 seconds. So if you haven't put in your response in the pop-up on your screen, now is a good time to do that. All right. So let's take a look at those results. All right. So we can see that there's been some movement, which is really great. I see that 9% of folks still feel like they don't have any knowledge or very little knowledge relating to pensions. 88% of folks now feel they have some knowledge, which is great. And 3% still feel they have a lot of knowledge. So we have seen some movements, which is great, but I'm sure folks are feeling like they may have some questions that they're looking to John to answer. So I'll remind folks here, if you do have a question, please type it into the chat box, my colleague Catherine Gagnon, who is running the Ask a Question account, will be able to put it into the pipeline to be asked. So I have one question here from Vander, and they are looking to a little bit, they're looking for a bit of information around the buyback option. Would you be able to provide any information on that?
Sure. So buybacks are an excellent benefit. And in order to qualify for one, you need to apply. And but let me first say how a buyback could happen. So if you go on a leave, like a maternity leave or something like that, and on your return, you're able to pay back your pension deficiency. And if you do not pay back that pension deficiency for whatever reason, then later on, that would turn into a buyback. Now, I have to stress that it's very important when you return from a leave to pay back that deficiency, because you generally have twice the amount of time to pay it back as you were off. So if you're off for 1 year, you would have 2 years to pay that back. And you wouldn't be paying any interest or penalties. On top of that, so you'd have 2 years to pay it back. But the problem would be that if you decided not to pay it back, then later on, you know, perhaps 10 years later, you know, you've had promotions, you've got a higher salary, and you say, boy, it would have been really nice to have that extra year, and you want to buy that back. Well, now, as I said, it's a buyback, and you're using your current salary plus interest, and so it's much more expensive. So you should always try to pay back the deficiency and maybe look out right away to see if you have any buybacks available, because the sooner you pay it back or buy it back, the better it will be.
Okay, that makes sense. Now, Vander also was asking about how they as a member get a hold of a pension expert for a personal session. So I think there's some differences between sort of the information that you and your team provide to members and the sort of thing they should seek out a financial advisor for. Can you give us sort of an idea of that split?
Well, we don't provide financial advice. So you can go through our Service Plus and get like some financial advisors through there, and they may be able to help you. You could also go to your bank and they can provide you some guidance on that type of thing. But PIPSC, we do not provide financial advice.
Right. So, I mean, you know, the information that we're providing today is sort of the information that we are able to provide to our members. So sort of generalities of how their pensions work and some of the provisions. Right. But if you're looking for personal pension advice, you should get the information from your HR department. So that way, you know, they can take into account your years of service and all of that stuff, and then look to an independent financial advisor for advice. Is that right?
Right. Okay. I saw a very interesting question here pop up on the screen, so I would like to take a shot at it. The question is, who does the current solvency requirement on target benefit plans? And if I could explain the risk behind seeking insolvency exemption. So the whole point of target benefit plans is to sort of get rid of the solvency exemption by having the plan evaluated every single year and to see if it's insolvent or not. And then if there isn't enough money, it would trigger the target benefit formula to say, okay, now that there's an insolvency, this is what you need to do. And it outlines what needs to be done. So now for the New Brunswick plan, I'm not fully up to speed on all the different aspects of it, but basically it would indicate what needs to be done first, second, third, and that would be, for example, the members deciding who's going to take the cut or pay extra contributions, etc. So who actually does the solvency test is the plan actuary. So I'm not sure if I answered the whole question, but the member can email me if they want further information on that.
Okay, that's great to know. And for folks that are have, you know, specific questions, you can send any questions you have to bettertogether@pips.ca, and you'll see that on a later slide. And we'll make sure that they get to John and members of that team for follow-up. And I do want to thank Rob for that question. It was actually next on my list. So I have another question from Lynn. And she has heard a rumor that there is an ideal time of year to retire. Is that true?
No, in a defined benefit plan, there is really no ideal time of the year to retire, because a lot of people think of that because of indexing, but it doesn't really matter, because in the following year, when once you've retired, the following year, you'll be prorated the indexing amount. So if you retired in June, you know, you would get half a year of indexing. If you retired in December, you wouldn't get any indexing. And of course, if you retired in January, you get the full year of indexing. So it's really not important what time of the year you retire. You retire when you want to retire.
I have a question for Mitch, and he's looking to see if you know of any cases where employers have not been able to make their payments in the workplace pension. He's thinking specifically of articles that sort of talk about looting pension funds. I think this is a concern that folks have. Would you be able to give a little sort of background?
So generally speaking, I mean, the public service superannuation plan, everybody probably heard that the government took out like 30 some odd billion dollars back in 1999 or so. But provincial plans under provincial registration and regulations, employers do not have access to the money inside the pension fund. So it's impossible for them to loot the pension plan. So that's part one. Part two is... just trying to remember here, part two would be if an employer doesn't contribute enough into the pension plan according to the actuarial cost certificate, then the regulator would go after the employer, indicating that they haven't contributed what they're supposed to contribute, and that you know, they're getting their hands slapped, etc. And this could go on to the point where they could be either fined, and it can get, you know, some of the fines can be quite serious. And every province has different legislation on how much the fines are and when the fines happen, et cetera. But the members don't need to be too worried about that part. The employer cannot raid the pension fund. That's one. And two, the government tries to make sure that the funds are put into the pension plan by the employer. But where it doesn't happen, then you have these fines that could happen. Of course, if the plan goes bankrupt, then it's a whole different, you know, a whole different story.
Okay. Okay. I have a question from Lucille, and she is asking, if my workplace pension makes my retirement income too high, is it possible that I will not receive any CPP or OAS benefits?
Well, for CPP, because you contribute into CPP while you're working in your career, that would never be clawed back. You get whatever CPP you're supposed to get. For old age security, that can be clawed back once your earnings are over roughly $80,000. Then you start being clawed back. And if your salary while or your earnings when you're retired are over $120,000, then you really wouldn't be getting any old age security. But for your CPP, you would always get that. That cannot be clawed back.
Okay, so your CPP, there's a question from Maria, and I think it's just sort of clarifying. So your CPP and your workplace pension, they don't sort of impact each other. Is that right? They're sort of two separate pieces?
Well, they're two separate pieces, but there is a little bit of an impact, because most of these defined benefit and target benefit plans are integrated. Not that there's any penalties, it's just the way the plans are written up that they're integrated to merge together with CPP or QPP in Quebec. So they do work together, yes.
Okay. But you receive two separate payments, is that right?
That's correct. You will receive one from Service Canada and one from your plan administrator.
Okay. I also have a question from Faison. He is looking to see how many years folks can expect to receive the CPP. We know our workplace pension goes until the member passes away, but what about CPP?
CPP also goes until you pass away, and then there's also a survivor benefit or a like a death benefit for your spouse.
Okay.
So it's just like your pension plan.
Let me just see what else we've got here. There's another question from Vander, and I'm not sure. I want to. The question is: I gather that in general, you get 2% of your income per year as a pension for each year of service. Is that true?
I don't know that's
much information to answer that, but I'll lob it to you anyways.
That's the rule of thumb, that it's around 2%, but in actual fact, you'd have to look at the plan formula. I unfortunately don't have the plan formula for the New Brunswick pension plan, which I think we're sort of referring to here today. But for example, for the superannuation plan, it would actually be 1.375% up to the YMPE. And so there would be something similar to this probably inside the New Brunswick plan. And then it would be 2% above the YMPE. And the YMPE is a number that CRA comes with every year. This year, where I think it was 56,300. And that's the amount that you pay your CPP on. So if you make less than 56,300 this year, you would not get a full credit for CPP. But if you make more than that, then you would get a full credit. So this is why, even your contributions would be, for example, 9.5% up to the YMPE, and then, for example, 11% above the YMPE. And that's because when you're below the YMP, you're also contributing into the CPP, so they give you a break on the contributions. And then once you've met that, they increase the contributions because that's a benefit over and above that. So overall, with your CPP, then you would be making 2% of your final average earnings, basically.
Okay. I've got just one more question here from Mahmood, and they're asking if there's any benefit in delaying your OAS if you're still working.
Okay, so OAS and CPP, you can delay, and if you delay, you would get slightly more. For CPP, it's... it goes up, I think, about 7.5% per year. So it could be significant for people who are still working and if they don't want to, but they have to start it at age 71. For old age security, I don't think the numbers are as dramatic, but we can't tell you if it's beneficial for you because I don't know your particular financial situation, et cetera. So when you're looking at, if you're getting over 60 and you're still working, you plan on working, you can look into, these aspects by going to the Service Canada website and checking how delaying OAS or CPP could be beneficial to you.
That's really good advice. Thanks for that, John. All right, folks, we're going to wrap up the question period here. Thank you so much for your excellent questions. And thanks to John for all that great information.
You're welcome.
So, we really appreciate it. So I just want to note that we will be sharing contact information at the end of this presentation. So please follow up if you still have any questions we weren't able to answer today. It's really important. Oh, sorry.
I saw one question here that maybe I would take another shot at. It says that the person would like to know how to find out how their pension fund is invested. So that you'd have to go check with your HR and, they would be able to pass you on to whoever the investment managers are, and they can tell you through their portfolios what they're actually invested in. For the public service pension plan, they've created a group called the Public Service Pension Investment Board, PSPIB. So if there's anybody listening here that's under the public service plan, they could go to that website and it'll indicate, you know, where, how they're invested, how it's all broken down. And you could do the same if you're in New Brunswick or any other separate employer pension plan. You would go to your plan administrator, your HR, and they could provide you with that information through their investment managers.
Okay, thanks for that. So as I mentioned before, we will be sharing contact information at the end of the presentation. So if there are additional questions that we weren't able to answer today, please, you know, feel free to reach out. It's important to note, as we did several times during the question period, that PIPSC does not have access to your personal pension information, but there is a lot of other great information out there available to you. So for government retirement programs, we recommend visiting the Government of Canada, Canada's website, their public pensions page. There you'll be able to find a lot of great information about CPP and QPP, OAS and GIS, as well as a calculator to help you understand your personal pension benefits. For personal savings options, there are a lot of resources available to you. Your financial institution or independent financial advisor can help you there. And for your workplace pension, you should contact your HR department. They can provide you with details about your specific plan. So before we let you go today, I want to give you a sneak peek at what's next for PIPSC. Today, we really only scratch the surface when it comes to pensions and retirement income security. Pensions are incredibly technical, and we could easily talk to you for hours and hours about this stuff. But today's session is about giving you a broad understanding of your pension and how it works so you can begin planning for your own retirement. And that planning should include working to protect your workplace pension. This fall, PIPSC will be launching our Protecting Pensions campaign. This campaign will take members to the next step, from understanding their pension and retirement security to action. We will be hosting more webinars and launching some great tools and working with members to lead initiatives in their workplace. And that includes folks who continue to work from home. So keep an eye out for an email soon about our first actions. So let's review what we've covered today. We've discussed the basics of different pension types with a closer look at how your specific pension type works. We've looked at the idea of retirement income security and the role your pension plays in that. And we gave you a sneak peek at our upcoming campaign and what you can expect to see from PIPSC this fall. So again, thank you so much for joining us. If you have any outstanding questions about this presentation or our upcoming campaign to protect pensions, please email us at bettertogether@pips.ca, and we will make sure that those pensions are routed to the right place. This session is being recorded, and when it is available, it will be emailed out to members. Thank you again for your time today, and have a great afternoon.